So good morning, and today we'll start with Jeremiah, chapter 17. And we'll read verses 5 through 8. Yahweh says, "Cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his arm, and whose heart departs from Yahweh. For he shall be like a bush in the desert, and shall not see when good comes, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, a salt land and not inhabited. Blessed is the man who trusts in Yahweh, and whose confidence is in Yahweh. For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, who spreads out its roots by the river, and shall not fear when heat comes, but its leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit." Amen. And our second reading will be Psalm 1. Very first psalm. Blessed is the man who doesn't walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand on the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in Yahweh's law. On his law he meditates day and night. He will be like a tree planted by the streams of water that produces its fruit in its season, whose leaf also does not wither. Whatever he does shall prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For Yahweh knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall perish. Amen. And from the New Testament, we'll go to 1 Corinthians 15. And we'll read the first 20 verses. Paul writes, "Now I declare to you, brothers, the good news which I preached to you, which also you received, in which you also stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold firmly the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to over 500 brothers at once, most of whom remain until now, but some have also fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. And last of all, as to the child born at the wrong time, he appeared to me also. For I am the least of the apostles who is not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the assembly of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. His grace, which was given to me, was not futile, but I worked more than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. Whether then it is I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. Now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, neither has Christ been raised. If Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith also is in vain. Yes, we are also found false witnesses of God, because we testified about God that he raised up Christ, whom he didn't raise up, if it is so that the dead are not raised. For if the dead aren't raised, neither has Christ been raised. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is vain. You are still in your sins. Then they also who are fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If we have only hoped in Christ in this life, we are of all men most pitiable. But now Christ has been raised from the dead. He became the first fruits of those who are asleep." Amen. Thank you, Lord. Couldn't hold him. And we'll finish with the gospel from Luke today, chapter 6. Start with verse 17. Speaking of Jesus, it says, he came down with them and stood on a level place with a crowd of his disciples and a great number of the people from all Judea and Jerusalem and the sea coast of Tyre and Sidon, who came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases, as well as those who were troubled by unclean spirits, and they were being healed. All the multitude sought to touch him, for power came out of him and healed them all. He lifted up his eyes to his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, God's kingdom is yours. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when men shall hate you, and when they shall exclude and mock you, and throw out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. For their fathers did the same thing to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe when men speak well of you, for their fathers did the same thing to the false prophets." Amen.
Let's go back to the old camp meeting days, right? That's where this song came from. It's been on my mind for a couple months off and on. I don't know what it's about, but I hope I didn't miss it. I think it's got a good message. Reminds you of the old camp meeting days. How's everything back there, son? A little difficulty? Facebook? Okay. Tech is great when it works. Anybody have a testimony? Anyone anywhere? Missy?
You know, I'm going to get some money out, get to my wallet. There's no debit card.
Oh, man.
And I didn't start freaking out. I'm like, okay, I'll just go inside and use, you know, my card. So I get in there. I have no driver's license.
Oh, my.
But I have a military ID, so I was able to use that. Still not freaking out. And I just really, I was just like, I already know God's got me covered. I didn't go, you know, I even called my boss and said, hey, can you check and see if I left it there? And but she did all the worrying for me. Okay. Oh my God, call, do this,
you
blah, blah, blah. And
do it.
I said, you know, I will call you back when it's in my hand. Not if, when.
Praise God.
And within 10 minutes, able to call her back. It was in my car.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Awesome.
It was just like, and I was able to say, you know, I'm like, this is what God,
amen,
his faith is like.
Amen.
You can't go to that dark, it's going to,
right,
be horrible,
right,
and,
right,
I'm going to be cheated and,
right,
scammed and this,
yep,
and that.
Yep. That's why I wrote your book. Anytime something happens, he's already got the, well, he's already putting it together. So words used for work. I like that picture, you know, we're betwixt and between, and right alongside that, God is putting together the alternative outcome. And he never takes us backwards. We're always better off and farther ahead, for even when something bad happens, which is why he allows it to happen. So it's like the devil loses 6 ways from Sunday. He does not get a break, you know? We don't want him to have a break. Another testimony. Oh, in the bulletin?
Yeah.
Wave, Debbie. Anybody doesn't know Debbie? That's Debbie. Yeah, these little prayer cloths are up here. Did you want to tell us?
Well, yeah, I went to the dentist Monday and had a toothache for a month, and finally got the schedule and got in there, and he said, oh, you're going to need a root canal. And I thought, oh, you know, and he started looking and started to work on it. And he said, no, you can't have a root canal. It's cracked.
Wow.
It's going to have to come out, which I was upset about that.
Sure.
But anyway, it's back in the back and it's fine. And he took it out and I was had x-rays and I was in there for probably an hour and a half.
Wow.
And I was getting ready to leave and I asked the girl, I said, you know, what do I owe you? And she said, nothing. And I said, what? Melanie, what? And she said, no. She said, you had a credit on your account, which I knew nothing about.
Wow.
And he discounted some things and you owe nothing.
Wow.
And it was because I think that little cloth lay
in your purse.
Was in my purse.
Amen. Amen.
That was such a blessing. I knew it was going to be hundreds of dollars.
Sure.
I was just, sick about it.
Yeah. Right? That's pretty pricey stuff. Probably close to $1,000.
Yes, that's what I was thinking. Yeah.
Yeah. And you see in the bulletin, someone else told me they put the prayer cloth in their wallet, and their rent was canceled for a month. So that beats a blank. But I like free. Anybody else? Anything good happen? Pat.
I'm just thankful that JB's here.
Yes.
When he fell on Sunday, it ended up being.
That was enough.
Not a big deal.
Wow.
It could have been.
Yeah.
It could have been.
You were on your way to church, weren't you?
Yeah.
Last week.
Yeah. He brought the car out, and I was going to come out the front door, and he got out of the car. What did you get out of
the
car?
Ice and snow.
Yeah.
He fell on the ice next in the driveway.
Yeah. Yeah.
But by the end of the day, he had a sore hand and a wrist.
Wow.
And
Praise.
That's a
he
miracle.
Could have said anything could have
That's right.
But God made a way.
You said he hurt the knife edge of his hand.
the
knife, yeah. So karate's out for a while for him. Joseph, you had one.
I met this guy while I was playing out. Our band was playing out, and we kind of become friends. And he told me his wife was. Die. And so I prayed for him. And the next day, he called me and said, Joseph, things turned around. He said, your ammonia levels are right. Everything was turned around. They were going to do a liver transplant
wow.
on her. If they could, she was going to die.
Wow.
So everything was just turned around. He said, I've never seen anything like this. He said, this is miraculous.
Awesome.
So that night he called me, he said, they're taking her to the university hospital. Something's going wrong, blah, 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 blah. And I said, okay, let's pray. So I prayed. I said, I don't accept this. We prayed. God's doing his will. The next morning he called me again. He said, Joe, everything's turned back around. And he said, they expect her to fully recover.
Double dip.
Not have anything wrong with
awesome.
Her.
Awesome.
From all the stuff that she was going through.
Sure.
I mean, it was so much, I can't even
sure.
name it all.
Yeah.
He said,
yeah.
It's all changed. He said, it's miraculous.
Awesome.
And so, all I've got to say is, if you're in God's way, God's going to use you.
Amen.
You know?
Yep.
I volunteered to pray to this drunk. He's a drunk. He's
yeah.
an alcoholic.
Yeah, yeah.
He's a great guy. He's a beautiful man. He's crying in his beard. He's
sure.
worried about losing his whole family.
Sure.
All this stuff. And he said, Joe, you've turned my life around.
Hallelujah.
So now he's volunteering his time to do a lot of stuff for us.
Awesome.
Maybe he's singing and play the harmonica with
Aww.
Us. I mean, everything's turned around.
Awesome.
He said he can't wait for his wife to meet me and his wife.
Right.
And I think this is going to be a beautiful
Never
thing
know.
In the future that turns him around. And you know how it is. Everybody
yep.
around him is going
oh,
to
yeah,
see
yeah.
this
yep. big doors or little
kings.
Yes, the good one. Yeah.
I noticed the part in the bulletin about 1 year since
yeah.
Pastor
yeah,
dropped dead.
It's tomorrow, yeah.
And I would just like to thank God for the people that
Amen.
He surrounded us with.
Yep.
Bill came to the hospital and prayed with us. And it was just nice having a face from outside.
Yep.
To lend some reality
yeah.
to the bizarre things that were going
yeah,
on. That
sure
night, we didn't know if you were alive or dead.
Yep.
And I thank God for Pat, who arranged for shoveling, and for Janet, who shoveled. And Bill brought me some Pepto-Bismol, which was much needed because of
yeah.
my nerves.
And Joe and Jen brought food, didn't they? Or sent food from Bob?
That's
from
right.
Bob,
that's
Jen.
Like, I know I've been wanting people.
Yeah, everybody and their brother. Yeah.
During so much of that
yep.
time.
Yep.
But I just want to thank God.
Hallelujah.
He brought
brought so much good out of it.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's stand together. We'll give him the praise. Yes.
Amen. I asked my old man who had a, you know, a lot of health trouble. I said, "Why are you still? You think you're still here, Dad?" He said, "I haven't suffered enough. So maybe I haven't either." This again is comes out of the archives. Some of you old timers know it. Almost every believer knows it. But 10 times, praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Yes. Amen. Amen.
It's all him. Amen.
Praise God. Amen. Let's give this a whirl. Oops.
Saints of God are fed. He invites his chosen people, come and dine. With his manna he will feed and supplies our every need. Through his strangers we go to all the time. Come and dine, bless your call. The multitude, turn the water into wine, to the hungry call it now, come and dine. The disciples came to land, for the master called unto them, come and dine. When they found their heart's desire, bread and fish upon the fire, as he satisfies the hungry every time. Come and dine, the master calleth, come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitude, turned the water into call it now, come and dine. Soon the Lamb will take his bride to be ever at his side. All the host of heaven will assemble be. It will be a glorious sight. All the rooms are spotless white, and with Jesus they will feast eternally. Come and dine, the master calleth, come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitude, turned the water into wine, to the hungry calleth now, come and dine. Come and dine, the master calleth, come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitude, turned the water into wine, to the hungry calleth. Come and dine.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Glory, 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 glory. It does. I don't know what I've had people tell me. They smell things, they see angels. Isn't God awesome? Isn't God awesome? Hallelujah. Missy smells roses. There are no roses in the room. God's flowers are in the room, right? I'll be a flower in his bouquet. What if some folks of ours, or God forbid, someone here, or someone watching or listening down the road, is not yet feasting or feeding there? I think this song speaks to a lot of people in this country and many, many others. Thank God we're able to talk to people, not just in this country, but at this last count, 181 nations. We've got some folks that are watching, they're listening, they're reading books, they're doing our courses. Somehow, some way, they're involved with us, and it's wonderful. Thank you, Lord. We're believing to go over 22,000 registrations by the end of the year from all of these countries. We pray for another 9. Give us 190 countries, Lord. And then finally, just mop it all up and give us someone in every place on earth. We're so close, Lord. We're so close. In honor of my old man, Lord, give us a round number. Bring us all the way up to the top. We bless you, Lord. We thank you.
Just as you are to worship.
Thank you for your open heart, your open arms. Thank you to the door to your kingdom is open. Hallelujah. Thank you that the invitation is there. Thank you, Lord, for the sign over your house. You don't have to be anyone. We can just walk right in. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your work. Thank you for your covenant with us. Thank you for the agreement with your Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for seeing to it that every blessing of the cross work of Jesus, every blessing of the atonement comes upon your covenant people. Thank you for calling us home, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for bringing us out of darkness into light, out from under the authority of the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of your dear Son, Father. Thank you. Thank you for a new heart, new mind. Thank you for a new attitude, a new destination, a new king, a new set of rules. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You're awesome. We love you. We love you. Hallelujah. I was saved in fall of 1972. 2 years later, I was privileged to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. So right about that same time, I heard about something that is called by different names. The one I heard most was entire consecration, which means not an unbeliever, a sinner, but a saved person gives their new life to Jesus unconditionally. Obviously not to be saved, but because they are saved, and to find out where they belong in the body of Christ. Looking at it in a military way, where am I? Am I a sergeant? Am I a corporal? Am I a private? Am I a gunner? And I made that unconditional surrender to the Lord. I was just almost finished with a journalism degree. I did that. When I went on, I found out God's place for me was ministry of the word. Not everybody's called to that. We're all called to serve him, though. And so, I don't know if you've done this or not. Many people have never even heard of this. I was on the evangelistic trail for years, and one of the sermons I would preach nearly every place I went, if it was more than one night, was this gift of your saved life to God. And oh, how did it help people? Man, I never knew where I was going. I was always in a fog. I knew I was saved, but couldn't figure out why. They would make that dedication just as definite as when they made Jesus Lord. Sometimes I'd hear from them later on the phone or whatever. They'd say, you can't believe how my life's changed. I said, oh yeah, I can. Praise God. It's wonderful. It's all we can do is give him our new life since he gave us salvation.
That comes.
We're painting a picture, if you haven't figured it out, with this music for the Word of God we're going to look at today.
Lord, I offer my life to you, everything.
Praise you, Jesus. Give you glory today. We honor you for who you are and what you've done. Who you are, Lord, and what you've done. Blessed be your name. For I am a God who lifts up the fallen ones, says the Lord. I am the one that passing by and seeing one in distress, unlike the priest, unlike the Levite, do not continue on my way, but I stop. I look and I listen, says the Lord, and I don't ask you to come to me. I come down to you. I examine you. I put you under the microscope of my Holy Spirit. I do a full exam. And then I personally pour in the oil and pour in the wine. I personally place the bandages. I personally carry you to the transport, and I ride with until you arrive at the healing center. I paid your way. I leave you at the healing center until I return. The healing center is my church, the body of Christ. The healers are those in the body. One taking blood pressure, another one drawing blood, someone else palpating the wounded place, someone else bringing meds. I have a full supply of everything and anything you will ever need here or hereafter, and I have a full staff. We're never understaffed in the body of Christ, in the kingdom of God. Whatever you need, we have. If we run short, we make new out of nothing. Cheer up, wounded ones. I have not forgotten you. My eyes are not closed. My ear is not deaf to your calls. I see what others don't. I do what others can't. Just let me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Worship you, Lord. Worship you.
You don't have to be afraid, says the Lord, to offer me your life, who you are, what you own, what you can be, all your dreams, your heart, your soul, your mind, your body. You don't have to be afraid to offer me everything, because I am a gentle God, and I will treat your gifts as treasure, and I will be gentle with you, and by my gentleness, you will be great. You will be great because you will be able to enter my throne room at any time, with any request, with any praise, with any thought that you have, with any help that you need. I am a gentle God, and I will treat you with gentleness. And by my gentleness, you can be great because you don't have to be afraid of me anymore. If you were, let that fear go, because you are always invited into my throne room, and you will always have my ear and my help and my attentiveness praise to your call, says the Lord. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid.
Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
I keep hearing the Lord say to not limit what he can do as the great physician, as the great God of the universe. And I keep thinking of these two verses, some of my favorite verses of the Bible, the text of my first sermon, and really the underpinning of this song we just sang, Romans chapter 12, 1 and 2, where it tells us to offer our bodies a living sacrifice, our reasonable service. And that second verse, don't be conformed to the image of the world, but be transformed. I feel like the Holy Spirit wants to apply that to us, that we might think, oh, well, how is God going to fix what's wrong with me? How am I going to get back what I have that I think I need to do what he's called me to do? That you can be transformed, not just restored, not just healed, but you can be made into something different in order to fulfill his purpose for your life. The thing that you never had can be added to you. The thing that you never envisioned can come upon you. The way that you thought you could never act can become your new method of living. So be transformed by that giving of yourself, and don't hold him back. Don't put him in a box. Don't put a box on him, but let him be God in your life and see what can happen.
Thank you, Jesus.
We offer everything, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Have your way, Master. Thank you, Master. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord.
Create, repair.
Our eyes are on you, Master. Our ear is open to your call. Speak, Lord, your servants listen. Help us to be, do, and have anything and everything you had in mind for us, Lord. When you called us from eternity past. Not according to our works or righteousness, but according to your own purpose and grace given us in Christ before the world began. That's what we want, Lord. Grace to finish our race, fight our fight, contest our contest. We're looking for the crown, Lord. In Jesus' wonderful name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can have a seat. God's wonderful. He's more than enough. He's not Brill Cream, little devil, do you remember that?
You probably hear that online. It's got a good message. If you didn't get this bulletin, please get it. All the information is there about what's going on. Sadly, our first note there is regarding our member, Mary Pickens, who passed away just this last week, Tuesday. I don't remember how many years she was a member and attending in person, probably at least two, I would think. I'd have to look at the directories. And then with the pandemic, I don't think she felt comfortable being around in crowds, so she just switched to online attendance and kept praying for us. You may remember her one son was at death's door when she let us know if there was there any way we could come and pray. He was unconscious when Solomon and I got there, anointed him with oil. The way I got the story from the staff, he was right on the edge of passing within a day. And sadly, I wasn't able to talk to him because he was unconscious, but we anointed him with oil, prayed the prayer of faith. Within 24 hours, he was out of that. Within just a little while, he was home. And it was no explanation for it. But we know the explanation. Amen? Amen? God's glory. If you need a prayer cloth or want one, I was amazed. I prayed for a handful of these, and they were gone. And then the fellow that comes from Kentucky comes on Wednesdays, the only time he can make it. He said, Pastor, he said, you talked about having a cloth in those baskets when you started this so many years ago. I said, yeah. He said, there's not one there. And I thought, wow. So they went like hotcakes and someone grabbed the one in the basket. But that's why we have them, right? And the testimonies are coming in. Yours might be next. So praise God. Appreciate the way God can use anything. And you might notice this little note about God gave me the ability and the privilege of sharing some books. This guy comes to change our fire extinguishers and kind of let us know what we need for the checkup this year. One thing led to another. We had a nice talk. He must have been here 40 minutes, and it wasn't just checking fire extinguishers. He went out with a load of books. And so he said, you write all these? I said, that's the theory. And we had a good time. I don't know where he goes to church. I think he kind of lives maybe a ways away, maybe Harrison or something like that. Anyway, he said he goes to a little Pentecostal church now, started out evangelical and then got the full gospel. But he looked like a man who had found precious treasure, you know. So he went out and said, I can't wait to dig into these books. But you just never know. I'm saying that again. It's like those prophetic words. God's got his people doing different things. Amen. And we just need to let him do it. I will be here, Lord willing, and the creek don't rise on Wednesday. But Solomon's going to be sharing the word. I'll be here. You never know. I may interrupt him and work him over. But no, he'll have a good word Wednesday. And maybe I'll do the Lord's Supper on Wednesday since he'll be teaching. So if you can spare 45 minutes, it would be great. If you have your Bible with you, let's turn to 2 Samuel chapter 4. We're going to look at verse 4. You see in the bulletin, we sang it. Today's message is on the theme, Come and Dine. Come and Dine. 2 Samuel chapter 4. We're going to look at verse 4 and some others. As we think about this invitation to come and dine. This is a bit of a paraphrase I'm giving now from this verse, 2 Samuel 4:4. And to Jonathan, the son of Saul, a son, crippled of feet. And he was a son of 5 years with the coming of the report about Saul and Jonathan from Jezreel. And his caretaker, she was lifting him up, and she was fleeing. And it was in her hurrying away to flee that he was falling, and he was becoming lame. And his name was Mephibosheth. That old gospel song has been with me for the last little while, as I mentioned. And the concept of intimacy with God, and as we're going to see in another text along this same line this morning, this man was given an invitation to dine at the king's table. And we're going to look at that today. Because this story from this portion of Scripture was applied to my life about 2 weeks ago now. Again, I think Greg and I maybe are somewhat kindred souls in some ways because we both seem to get up in the middle of the night. not just to use the restroom. It's a divine thing. And I've had some fabulous experiences in the middle of the night. I preached from one last Sunday. I mentioned it Wednesday. And I had this one. And I, for whatever reason, began being transported in the middle of the night while I was in communion with God back to my childhood and my young adult years and growing up. And I remember not so much the good things, but pretty much like you and most people, I remembered a lot of the bad things. And I began to think about those. And I began to wonder just how much has that changed my life and my personality. The fact that this happened, that happened, the other happened, this that should have happened didn't happen, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And God brought this story to me in the middle of the night powerfully. And he basically let me know, if we want to be, we can all sit where this guy sat. And the thing that he got over to me was, I have always wanted you. I want you now. I wanted you then. I've wanted you from the foundation of the world when I called you to be a child of God, to be one of my elect. I've never changed my mind. And all of those things you're thinking about from your past that you feel disqualify you from being, quote unquote, a normal person, all of those things are as nothing in my eyes. You are a wanted child. And I just rejoiced and rejoiced and rejoiced. And how do you know when you've really heard from God? When the change remains. When you find yourself not losing it because someone says something awkward to you or lets you down or perhaps does something even worse, you don't find yourself falling apart. Because you think to yourself, I prefer to be treated nicely, but if you treat me nicely, you're not adding anything to me. If you treat me badly, you're not taking anything from me. I'm complete in the one in whose image I have been made and created and recreated. And that never changes. Let's look at this together, and please, will you just read yourself in? We're going to look at this bad beginning regarding this little boy, and then we're going to look at the invitation to come and dine. Read yourself in. I noticed that Lockyer makes some very fine points in a brief article he wrote in one of his books about this little boy that we're looking into. And I feel like this article that he wrote will serve as a jumping off point to pull out some truths from this story that will cause us to resonate with them and change our lives. Again, the text, and to Jonathan, the son of Saul, a son, crippled a feet, and he was a son of 5 years with the coming of the report about Saul and Jonathan from Jezreel. And his caretaker, she was lifting him up, and she was fleeing, and it was in her hurrying to flee that he was falling, and he was becoming lame. And his name was Mephibosheth. That's basically the summary of the story of the end of the battle at Gilboa. You may recall that this boy's father, Jonathan, and his grandfather, Jonathan's dad, Saul, both perished in that battle. And guess what? He was still in the royal line. Would you like some good news today? You may not realize it. You're in a royal line. Oh, no, but I messed up. Doesn't matter. Oh, no. You don't know what happened to me. That disqualified me. No. You're still in the royal line. You are still in the royal line. Just like this young fellow, when his dad and grandfather were slain in battle, he remained in the royal line of kingship. Did you know that his name translates to utterance of Baal? Baal is a false god, of course, symbolized by the moon. His name means, I'll be a broadcaster for a false god. I'll be an evangelist for Baal. But if you study it out, he's also called in other scriptures, not Mephibosheth, but Mary Baal. Mary Baal. I like this. That translates to striver against Baal. Now, isn't that a beautiful before and after? You think of some of these people that have led horrific lives, and God reaches down,
grabs them, pulls them out of the muck and mire, grants them a new birth, baptizes them in the Holy Ghost and fire, and some of them become gifted as apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, and they go out and they turn the world upside down. How fantastic is that? Those who used to blaspheme the God of heaven are given a new mouth. Those whose hearts were hard toward God suddenly become mush boys. I wrote to my friend, Pat. He's the president of a seminary. And I told him, among other things, I said, boy, in my older years now, I've become a real mush boy. He wrote me back. He said, don't worry about it. I'm kind of a weepy willy myself. If you think about it, pray for him. His name's Pat. He's the president of a seminary out in Texas. My boyhood, childhood friend. We made little Super 8 movies together and whatnot. And he was driving somewhere in Texas in his little pickup truck, and he was at a stop sign or a red light one, and this huge truck came by with an uninsured driver, blasted through and smashed and totaled his truck. He came out of it with an ankle broken in three places. I think one would be enough. How about you? And a broken sternum. And he told me, he said, Joey, whether you don't know this, he said, you know, as we age, it takes longer for bones to heal. He said, I'm looking at another 2 months of recovery. And so please pray for Pat that he gets, how about if he finishes this month? I think that would be good enough. Lord, supernaturally speed up the recovery. Bless his heart. He's not necessarily theologically comfortable with laying on of hands and these things, but he believes in the same God we do. He's born again from the same Holy Spirit we are. Lord, just eliminate the middleman in his case and deal direct, Father, please. Just do something directly. Let him know it was still the hand of God, the touch of God. He's asked for prayer. Let it be a 1 month recovery. Let him walk out of this, Lord. Maybe even today, let him walk out of this. Let me hear back from him that something happened and everything's new and brightly beautiful. It's beautiful when God can turn us into something we could have never been before, but that's what he does. He started out as the utterance of Baal. He wound up a striver against Baal. Now, his physical affliction, think about this. It illustrates, I believe, everything about our lives being born of Adam, right? It reminds us of what the poet called the fall, that felled us all. Think of this. This young man was destined to be a prince, but through no fault of his own, through the failure of someone else, he became a pauper. He became immobilized. Isn't that what happened to you? Isn't that what happened to me? Isn't that what happened to every person on planet Earth? Because of someone else's fall, Adam and Eve, you and I come into this world separated from fellowship with God. We're destined for the throne. We're in the royal line. How many believe that? Hey, if you don't, think about this. When Paul was on Mars Hill in Acts 17, thank God, I've been privileged to be there 14 times. When he was on Mars Hill, he was talking to the philosophers, and among other things, he said this: we are all the offspring of God. A saved Jewish preacher using the term we, including him with unsaved pagan Greeks from Athens. We are all the offspring of God. We're born children of God, but we are damaged children. We are prodigal children until we come back to the Father through the Lord Jesus Christ. You don't believe that, Acts 17, 28. Even though this man was a prince due to the failure of another, his little housemaid, he became and remained crippled for life, and so are you and so am I. Isn't this true of all of us? I was talking to a friend of mine months ago now. I'm sure she doesn't know it. I hung up and just cried after our conversation. I thought to myself, you know what? I need to talk to her more often. We got a lot in common. She's up in years, not a young person, not an old person, but not a young person. And she was telling me about some things that were coming to her mind. Is it because we're getting old that this happens? I don't know. She said, suddenly I'm remembering things that I had repressed from my childhood. Hurtful, awkward, horrible things. And she said, as I thought about these different experiences that I had apparently buried, I began to connect the dots, and I thought to myself, oh, so that's why I acted like that. So that's why I was afraid of doing the other. So that's why I held myself back from this. She said it all began to make sense. And she paused. And she said, I've been thinking lately, Pastor. What if that hadn't happened? What if those things hadn't been done to me? What if those different experiences had never entered my life? Real wistfully. You could almost expect the music to come up. It was like a scene from a movie, only there was no visual, just audio. She said, I wonder who I could have been. I wonder what I could have had. I wonder what I could have done. Don't you think this went through this young man's life as a theme? Don't you think he heard these words in his own heart, looking around, watching the other kids run around playing, wrestling, tossing the ball around, winning the Super Bowl? Don't you think he looked at all of that and he was not allowed to play? Have you ever been there? Not taken for the team? I was always the add-on, they were to the very last. He's still, you too, Greg. He's still left up. We'll give you him and him. Okay, twofer, we'll take it. I wrote a little book years ago. I'm going to try to get it back in print, called A Horse of a Different Color. And in that book, the star of the book, the little horse, says he always felt like he was on the outside looking in. I suggest to you that there are not just hundreds or thousands. I suggest to you there are multiple hundreds of millions of people. That's their experience of life. They interact with people, but inwardly they never feel part of it, because of who they perceive themselves to be and their shortcomings. And they're coming up short. They feel that they're on the outside somehow looking in at everybody else enjoying the party, and they can't connect. They can't seem to get through the front door because of something that happened to them that made them immobile, physically, perhaps literally, or emotionally, or psychologically, or perhaps even spiritually. Think about this. As we continue this story, even though he lived, this young man, in exile from the new king, King David, he was at least remembered by the king due to a covenant between his father, Jonathan, and David. You can read about that in 1 Samuel 20, verse 14. 1 Samuel, we're in 2 Samuel. 1 Samuel 20, verse 14. Jonathan basically says, hey, can you promise me this, my brother David? If things go south, will you at least remember my line? Will you at least remember my descendants? And David agreed. Think about this. That's a picture of the Father's covenant with his Son, the Lord Jesus. We will save humanity since you have agreed to take their place and to shed your blood and to die in their place and in their name, to be buried and raised from the dead that they might have eternal life. Since we have this agreement, I will bless them because of you. Hallelujah. David said, because you and I have this agreement, I'm not just going to bless you, my blood brother, Jonathan. I'm going to bless anything that comes from you, including, he would find out later, a crippled boy who started life on the wrong side of the tracks. Bad beginning. Let's look at the come and dine part. Fast forward. Think about this boy now, who's now a teenager. He's no longer five. He's in his teens. And where was his handicap, beloved? In his feet. Feet in the Bible speak of mobility. So he was immobile in his feet. He couldn't go where he wanted to go when he wanted to go there. He was at the mercy of others. That's how he started his life, at the mercy of someone who dropped him. And he suffered for their mistake, just like you and I suffer spiritually for the mistake of Adam and Eve, the fall that felled us all. Symbolic of immobility in all areas of life. What about hands? Same thing, right? Your hands talk about you and what you're able to do. Who can ascend to the hill of the Lord? Those with clean hands. Doesn't mean you use lava soap. It means your lifestyle is good. You have not used your hands, as it were, to harm others. And feet, of course, can be used in much the same way. Twice in the Old Covenant, how beautiful are thee, what? Of those who do what? Preach the gospel of peace. Boy, I was embarrassed 6 ways from Sunday years ago. A little church I attended and eventually pastored had a foot washing once a year. Oh, I used to cringe from those. And so, and fortunately, they usually only use 1 foot. How many have been to one? 1 foot or two? Two? Wow, you guys, you lot got two. I got off easy. This was a one bagger. So I always put my right foot out. I thought if anybody sees my left foot, they're not going to think anything's beautiful. Since I was 13 years of age, I've been building a reservoir of lipomas, non-cancerous fiber things, just little bumps. I must have 30 on my left foot. Not cool, not beautiful, but you know what? That's only in the natural. Mary Bales' problem was only on the outside. He thought that disqualified him from doing something for God, but it didn't, because God doesn't look at the outside. He looks at the inside. I mentioned it in my book when I came down from the operating theater and was in that recovery room. The cardiologist came in, and he said, just wanted to check on you, see everything's okay. I said, yeah, I'm good. And, you know, with the COVID and all that. I said, hey, doc, I said, would you mind if I, could I shake hands with you? Sure. So he walked over, shook my hand, and while I had his hand, I turned his hand over, kissed the back of his hand. He just stepped back a little bit. You know, I don't think he really knew that was going to happen. But I felt that grateful. And I wrote in my book, I'm not going far afield here. I'm still talking about my feet. When I wrote in my book, why did I do that? Because I was grateful. And I think we should show gratefulness to anyone and everyone who helps us any way God leads us, right? That's just what I felt to do. I've been on the other end of that. Have you? Isn't that something? When someone is grateful, thanks you, maybe in a real demonstrative way. I've been to Greece 14 times. I don't know what trip it was, but I remember it like it was yesterday. I'm on the platform, Brother Jimmy's over here. We're giving the altar call. I don't know how many hundred people came to the front of that auditorium. And I'm standing there, and he's translating what I'm exhorting, and all these people crowded, and ushers trying to keep them back, and all of this. And while I'm talking, and he's interpreting me, I feel something on my foot. I thought, what on earth is someone trying to steal my shoe? What is it? And I looked down. And you know, Greek women, especially older women, wear a lot of black. And there was a woman, I would suggest she was 80, 85, maybe older, bent over with a black shawl over her head, kissing my shoe. Because she had heard the gospel maybe for the first time in her life and realized there was more than the state church, the Orthodox church in Greece. There was a relationship with God. And my accent didn't seem to bother her. And I've never forgotten that. You wouldn't either. Now think about this. This is a bad setup, bad beginning, but watch how everything changes. All because of someone else. All because of someone else. You and I got in trouble with God because of someone else, Adam and Eve. We get out of it because of someone else. Anybody know who he is? Jesus. Watch this. 2 Samuel 9, verse 7. This is now Mary Bale is a teenager. And David, he was saying unto him, stop fearing. Get out of fear. Stop fearing because acting, Hebrew way of speech, because acting, I will certainly be acting with you with grace on account of Jonathan, your father. And I will permanently restore to you all the fields of Saul, your father, the best for last, just like you, just like me. And you will be eating bread at my table. Wow. 2 Samuel 9:7, come and dine. This symbolizes the Father welcoming us because of the agreement with his Son Jesus. And the Bible says all of Saul's blessings fell to Mephibosheth. It kind of reminds you of what the father of the prodigal said to the elder brother. Do you remember that story? We know all about the prodigal. What about the elder brother who had his nose out of joint watching the old man squander the best on the worst? And he came and told his old man, "You never did anything like this for me. I never even got a cheeseburger, let alone sirloin." What did the old man say? "Son, yours, son, you are always with me, and each and everything I have is yours." How many believers, because of who they think they are on the outside, or who someone else told them they were, or because of what someone else did to them that made them immobile physically, emotionally, spiritually, psychologically. How many of us feel like we're not qualified, not worthy of the blessings that are ours, even though we know we were in the princely line? How many continue to live below their means? The "you" here is emphatic, and you will be eating bread at my table. Wow! Go there in your imagination. How many people did David scan over and ignore to put his attention on the also-ran, the off-brand, the wrong side of the tracks, the loser? And yet it didn't matter. This is the promise of ongoing, intimate fellowship with the king anytime we want it. Here's the sad part. I feel like this young man's response is ours. And he was prostrating himself. And he was saying, "What is your servant that you have permanently turned toward the dog, the dead one, which is me?" What is your servant that you have permanently turned toward the dog, the dead one, which is me? You ever felt like that? On the outside looking in? Not just a dog, a dead one. Bible days, a dog symbolized someone out of covenant with Israel, out of covenant with Yahweh, the worst of the worst. And this is what this man says of himself. That's what I thought in the middle of the night. Who in the world would want me? Some of you think, after what's happened to me, after the way I was treated, that ought to tell anybody this is what this person's worth of. Is this what he's worth? This is the way this person needs to be treated after all. This is who he is. This is who she is. No, it's not. Did you notice something in that text? What did David say to this man calling himself not only a dog, but a dead one? What did he say? How did he respond? He didn't. David didn't see him the way he saw himself. Middle of the night, the Lord showed me he doesn't see me like I see myself. David didn't see him like other people saw him. God doesn't see you or me or any believer as other people see us, or as Satan sees us, or as our in-laws or outlaws see us. He sees us through the lens of love, not through the distorted image of fallen flesh. He doesn't see us as we see ourselves. Sometimes the best response is silence. Next time somebody says, "Who do you think you are?" the response is silence. You can basically say, "If I told you, you wouldn't believe me. I came from beyond outer space. I came from God. I'm only here to know God, to make him known. I'm going back to God. My stripes don't match your stripes." "Well, you're full of everything negative I could ever imagine." "Really? Where?" It's like that old gospel song. We bring all of our mess to God, and he says, what sins are you talking about? What faults, failures, and foibles are you talking about? I don't see anything but my own image. Here it is, beloved, when you and I grasp this, that he wants us for us and not for what we can do, everything changes and we can finally accept ourselves. Isn't that a great day when we can finally accept ourselves? Come and dine. The young man responded, if you study it out, by living a life of self-denial during David's absence. 2 Samuel 19:24, you read there, he didn't do his beard, didn't change his clothes, didn't put any cologne on. He was just denying himself. That's what you and I are doing, aren't we? While we wait the return of our king? Sure we are. 2 Corinthians 5:15, Paul said, hey, since we believe that one died for all, then those who have risen should spend their lives living for the one having been raised from the dead. Isn't it only natural? That little dial message I had last week, I changed it, was about someone buying a slave, a mulatto person back in the day. And this girl was, you know, just horrified until the man said, you're free. I just bought you to set you free. Oh, this isn't the normal slave purchase. Oh my gosh, you just paid money for me to give me my life back so I'll no longer be subject to being sold? Yes. Well, I'd like to work for you the rest of my life. That's a picture of what it means to be saved. And don't misunderstand, it wasn't all sunshine and roses just because he was accepted by David and you and I are accepted by God. It wasn't all sunshine and roses for him. It won't be for us. The Bible tells us in 2 Samuel 16:3, he was persecuted and slandered. Think about this. He wanted to go out, saddle a donkey, go out with some food and meet David. And what did his servant say? Oh, no. You stay here. I'll take care of that. And in David's eyes, it looked like he couldn't care less because he didn't care enough to come out. His servant told David, I'll tell you why he's not here. He wanted to wait home so he didn't miss out on the inheritance you told him you were going to give him. Slandered him, his own servant. I was going to tell you a story, but I won't. Let me put it this way. I had someone, another minister of God, speak on my behalf to some board members that wanted desperately to talk to me one-on-one. You know what he said? Oh, no. He's not interested in talking to you. He don't want anything to do with what you're talking about. They were wanting me to take over the church that was falling apart. He wanted to be pastor. It's not all sunshine and roses in the body of Christ, is it? But God is with us, and he'll keep us from trouble, even when others try to cause it. How many are glad about that? What's the takeaway? Let's learn from this cautionary tale. Let's let God's unconditional acceptance of us become ours. Let his view of us become our view of us. And let's serve him and serve others. Father, thanks for the invitation to come and dine. We're tired of measuring others by our half a bushel or having them measure us. We're tired of looking at somebody else's shirt collar when ours is dirty. We're tired of people doing us that way, Lord. We just want to adjust our self-image, not to theirs, to ours, but to yours. We're tired of trying to figure out who's right. I'm right or are you right? Am I right or am you right? We just want to know what's right. We're likely both wrong. We just want to begin living, Lord, from a higher point of view. We thank you for looking at us and not seeing what we see, not seeing what's happened to us, but seeing who we are and what we can become. What you did with Paul, Christian killer. You made him the greatest Christian ever lived. Thank you, Lord, for what you can do for us and through us to others. Thank you for your view of us that can become ours so that we can bless others and help them find their new identity in you, not in others who have hurt and abused them, but in you. We thank you, Lord, when we come into your presence with what we perceive as our flaws. We thank you, Lord, that we don't hear any response from you, because you don't look at us through the flesh, you look at us through the lens of love. We need it, Lord, daily, and we thank you for it. We ask a blessing on those who pray, attend, support, and serve. We ask a blessing, Lord, on those partnering with us in other states and other nations of the world. And we thank you for those who do something constructive for this church or this ministry. It's all working together for good, Lord, and we're astounded. We're astounded at every new day. Bless us as we come around your table, as we give thanks for these gifts, Lord, as we distribute them, as your people receive them. And then finally, Lord, as your words are spoken over them, we thank you for the miracle of sacramental union, your precious body and blood in heaven somehow at the same time, in with and under this bread and cup of the supper. Change our bodies, change our minds, change our souls, change our spirits, change everything about us. Lord, through the anointing in these cloths, change our finances. Make your people magnetic to money miracles and radioactive to the work of the enemy. In the wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.
Lord of all, filling all my
Are you ready to see the finished work on display, proclaiming the death of the Lord as we eat and drink? See this bread, which contains his body that was broken for healing, for deliverance, for restoration. And see this cup that holds the blood that purchased our full and eternal redemption. Protection from every evil. Hallelujah. The seal of the new covenant. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you for being in our midst, King of glory. Hallelujah. Word made flesh.
Glory to God.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you." And in the same way, he took the cup after the supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink from it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, being poured out for you for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink in memory of me."
Praise the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. If you need prayer today, we're glad to pray with you, for you. If you're not sure about your relationship with the Lord, we're glad to pray about that. Not sure you're filled with the Holy Spirit, glad to pray about that. Those of you watching who can't just come over here and get one of these cloths if you believe that God can work through something physical, something natural,
that it can become supernatural. When God gets involved, we'd be glad to send you one of these little cloths that we've prayed over to help you in your finances. This has been helping our church for, well, since 2013. It's a long time to be out of debt as a church, especially through a pandemic. Your attendance is just a small fraction of what it once was, and yet nothing changes. If you weren't here Wednesday, when I mentioned it a few times in the past, perhaps you're watching the first time, or you're just hearing this as you're jogging. We were in a bad way as a church in 2013, and early in that year, the Lord ministered to me while I was praying. You use prayer cloths for healing, for deliverance from demons, as in Acts 19. Why can't you use a prayer cloth for finances? Never thought about it. Immediately prayed over prayer cloths, put one in each offering basket, one in the church checkbook, one in mine. Friends of mine put one in their wallet. Things began to turn around over those next few months until finally in October, one lovely couple gave the ministry the largest one-time gift we've ever received. When that came, the Lord said, once the deliverance comes, you'll never be in debt as a church again. We have not been. This is, I think, the sixth year we've gone over budget with this attendance in these days. Most of you know I'm not a money preacher. We don't have special, you know, Jewish feast day. Get in now while you still can before the Lord changes his mind. We don't do anything like that. We like to stick with the scripture. But if God tells me to do something, I'm going to do it. And again, it's not for everybody, and I mean that sincerely. It's not for everybody. That doesn't resonate with you. Don't worry about it. But if it does, you may be just one phone call away from a miracle or one email. Just give us a good mailing address. We'll send it to you. Just sent my new book and a prayer cloth to a friend in England. Someone gave her my book, The Perfect Weapon, and read it, and she read it and then began to follow us on Facebook. You never know how it's going to work, how it's going to happen. Someone comes in to check our fire extinguishers, leaves with a bunch of books. I don't know what he's going to do with those, but he's a lovely guy, and maybe he's going to bring forth a lot of fruit wherever he's planted. So it's good, isn't it, to be in the house of God and to be in the family of God and not to be limited anymore by this junk. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yahweh, may he bless us and protect us. Yahweh, may he make his face shine upon us and be gracious and merciful toward us. Yahweh, may he lift up his face upon us, grant us his shalom. Yahweh, we ask you to take the players, the staff, and everyone and anyone connected with this huge sports event tonight. Take them, Lord, wrap them in your arms of love. Let there be peace and safety, Lord. Let there be protection and provision. Let there be, Lord, a game without significant injuries. We thank you, Lord, that you're able to do so much more than we can ask. Thanks in advance for a wonderful homegoing celebration for Mary on Thursday. Thank you for a beautiful service Wednesday. Put words in Solomon's mouth that come from heaven. Thank you, Lord, for allowing me the privilege of doing the supper on Wednesday. Thanks for all you're doing in us and through us, working everything together for good. We give you the glory, Lord, for the good words coming in, the miracles taking place, and we know as we walk with you, the best is yet to come. Amen. God bless you. Amen. There's something for your pancreas out there, plus coffee.
Thank you.